have some announcements to make. Now is a perfect time to get those open, to open up your cans before our speaker starts, so please do that. Tonight at, remind me, 7 o'clock?
Yes.
Is the film night in this room. We have a documentary, okay, that will be presented, a short documentary to start, and then I have three, you know, feature films that we can vote on and choose which ones we want to watch. And so that'll be in this room tonight at 7. I was also told to announce that we are in need of a makeup person for tomorrow's fashion show. Apparently we lost a makeup person. So if anyone knows of anyone or is a makeup artist, see Heather, ASAP. Okay, so today we conclude our Michael Cabote lecture series. And again, to remind you, and you guys are the hardcore people because you're here all the way through till the end, till Thursday. Again, our concept was continuum. And we looked at that with Freddie's wonderful lecture about food on Tuesday. And I complimented him. You know, it wasn't what I was expecting. I don't think it was the kind of talk that the natives were expecting. I don't think it was the kind of talk that the non-natives were expecting, and that is great. That's where things really start happening and coming together, so kudos to them. We also learned a lot. Obviously, I have no fashion sense, so I certainly enjoyed yesterday's talk and will enjoy the show, the fashion show, tomorrow at 7 in the IAF Theater, which is up the hill. So continuing with this idea of continuum, we have here Philip Espinoza. He's a member of the Mesa Grande Band of Mission Indians. He graduated from UC San Diego in 2011 with a bachelor's in political science. And today he is a program coordinator for Intertribal Sports, which is a Southern California organization which gets youth and adults to?
Yeah.
Active and doing things. Now, this idea of continuum, and I don't know if any of you have noticed, but I'm thinking, Freddie, how old are you? 38. So I think this is the first year every speaker has been younger than me. And I do believe that Phyllis is the youngest speaker we've had in this series ever. And so this idea of continuum is these young people are picking it up. And I got to tell you, what you're going to hear today, really important, really inspiring. It's been a long time since I've been inspired by a young person like I have with Philip. And I met him through my cousin probably 2 years ago. And what he's done, what he's going to present today is very important and truly continues that idea of continuum. And not just food or fashion or art, but here in maybe social awareness, I think. So with no further ado, Mr. Philip Espinoza.
I'm going to decide if I'm going to use this mic or not, so
I might switch back and forth a little bit. But first of all, I just wanted to thank Gerald for the introduction. Thank you for having me here in the first place. You know, first of all, thank you to this the original people of this land for allowing me and allowing us to occupy this space. And you know, I think it's always important for me personally. To make that connection to the area and the land around us before we get started with anything. But yes, thank you for having me here today. What I'm here to talk to you about is not this Apple software update, so I'm going to close that. But I'm going to talk to you about my 90-mile spirit run. And what this really means is it's a lot of different layers wrapped up into this one event. It's more than just running 90 miles. What it really symbolizes is, you know, just kind of, it has a political aspect, it has a cultural aspect, obviously a health and wellness physical aspect. There's just so many things that this run envelops that I'm here to talk to you about and why exactly this is significant, not only for me, but for the people in my community and other people in different Native communities around this area and all around the world. And so I'm sharing with you what I learned on my 1-year endeavor. So this training And this whole event just took 1 year for me to train to be able to do this. And so I will go into that in more detail about how this whole thing started. Well, how it began is I was, it actually began a while ago. You know, growing up, I was always the overweight kid. You know, up until about college is when I started like slimming down. But for the most part, for most of my young life, I was always the overweight kid. You know, I got up to about 235 pounds as a kid, so 5'2", right? And that's something that, you know, was outside of my control. It's something that a lot of Native communities struggle with. And, you know, a lot of Native kids have to, they get passed on these lifestyles. You know, not because the parents want to pass it on to them, but it's just because that's been the lifestyle and the culture, the modern day culture that's been passed on down to us. So in a lot of ways, my story represents kind of an aspect of the Native community that, you know, where you have a lot of issues and a lot of post-colonial effects from colonization, you know, just with the drugs and alcohol. I grew up with a lot of those problems around me. And I think just the weight issue was something that was personally manifested in myself. And so I was never really a runner at all. And I think that's really important to kind of preface that, because if somebody hears, like, somebody did a 90-mile run, it's like, well, that's great. People do that all the time. You know, you have those runner people who do it all the time. I was never one of those runner people. So for me, doing this was really just a challenge outside of anything that I even comprehended that I would be able to do. Right? So it started, that's the context, the pre-context for it. But it really started in June 2011 when I graduated from UCSD. I was involved in a lot of Native student politics. And, you know, it was just it's an elemental part of my life where I just graduated college. I was 22. Was I 22? Dang. Yeah, I'm 24 now. So I was 22 years old. I'm fresh out of college. And, you know, it was just the question of what am I going to do, right? What am I going to do with the rest of my life? I'm young. And what happened is I spent a lot of my free time just dedicated to social work, putting on a powwow for UCSD, and just really that ended up catching back up to me. So where I was slim when I started freshman year, by the end of senior year, I was back to 235 pounds, so back to my heaviest weight. And so with that, you know, I just started going to the gym more often, and eventually, you know, just kind of with enough running and just kind of doing it for fun and doing it for health and wellness purposes, it came to me one night, and actually Whitney was here to kind of, she was there to witness the idea as it came to me, but it happened one night after a run, and it happens, you know, if anybody runs in this room, you get, you know, the runner's high, you have endorphins, but really what came to me at that moment was, I was looking up at a dark, you know, it was a dark night, and what came to me at that moment was the smell of sage. And so the smell of sage is something that I grew up with. And I thought to myself, you know, if I could smell sage, if I could use that to help me, I could probably run for a really, really long time. Right? And so that's how it started, right? And so I started thinking about that, you know, the power of sage and how that would help me run a long time. And then I started thinking, like, I wonder if anybody in my family has run a really long distance. Like, you know, you have marathons and stuff, but I wonder which, or if there's somebody in my family who I can look up to who has run a crazy distance. And, I mean, to my knowledge, there isn't, you know. And so there are reasons for that that I kind of alluded to earlier. But then I started looking back to past generations, you know. Is there anybody in the generation preceding mine that have done something crazy? Because I know I can point to, you know, generations way before that we used to have runners who we used to assign tasks of delivering messages to. Like, I'm Kumeyaay, so my area is San Diego. Spanning from the ocean to the desert, you know. So it's well known that generations before, we've had runners who run crazy distances, right? But I'm trying to think to kind of personalize that and make it closer to home. And so I thought about one of the stories that's well circulated within my family about my great uncle Alfonso Soto. And then we'll go into that with the next slide. And so the idea is with my great uncle Alfonso Soto, he attended Sherman Indian School back in his boarding school days. It's still a school, but it's obviously moved past those, you know, those terrible boarding school days. But what the boarding school represents for a lot of Native Americans who lived in that era is just basically an era of assimilation where you had the Western world just trying to assimilate natives to be, you know, European, to operate in a way that, you know, they believe is civilized. You know, one of the famous boarding school sayings, kill the Indian, save the man, right? So, obviously, my uncle didn't have a really, didn't have a good experience at all there. And so he, and this is stories that my dad keeps telling me, so it's just something that's just kind of been bred into me. He ran away from Sherman Indian School back home to Mesa Grande. And so when he would tell me that, I would hear it and be like, dang, you know, it sounds like a folktale. But when I actually started to think about it, I'm like, dang, that's a really, really long distance. I wonder how long it is. So I looked it up, and, like, the shortest distance between Sherman and Mesa Grande was 90 miles. And I'm like, dang, that's crazy. How did he, I mean, even if it took him a week or 2 weeks, how did he even go that distance, like 90 miles? So it's like looking back a generation before mine and seeing, like, if he was able to do it, then there should be no reason why I am not able to do it. And so that's when the idea occurred to me that I'm going to have to do this personally. This is going to be like a personal thing, right, to help me guide myself better for any kind of future decision that I make with my life. So I felt that doing this 90-mile run will connect me to a part of my past and a deeper part of myself, which will help me ultimately decide what I'm going to do with my future. Right, so it sounded crazy. I can't even remember how just amazed I was at the thought that I even would even think that I could do that, right? Like 90 miles, when that came to me, I'm like, this sounds crazy. And I think I remember telling Whitney, this sounds crazy. But this is something where it's like, I'm going to have to do this. I'm going to have to run 90 miles. And so this is one of those things that I wasn't really conscious of it. And this goes back into, I learned so much from this running itself, but this is something where I feel like I wasn't really a conscious agent in it. It's something that really just occurred to me and it happened to me, right? It was placed upon me, right? But this is a picture of my great uncle Alfonso Soto to the left, along with my grandpa Joe Espinoza on the right. And this is a picture of my grandma Catherine Soto from Mesa Grande. So again, driving back the idea of connection to the past. And this is just more information about, you know, the boarding school story. You know, in the late 1800s is when Sherman Indian School specifically became one of the top or most well-known in California, one of the most well-known boarding schools in California. And so, you know, just the whole story, it's just, you have stories with bars of soap being put in kids' mouths and just really cruel and unusual punishment, right? Eighth Amendment. And so we have, I made this slide right here, and this again is going back to the past and relating it back even further, right? So this is something that we have a leadership program for Intertribal Sports, and this is one of the things that I use to talk to the youth about. And this slide talks about carrying the legacy of our ancestors, right? And so what that means is kind of looking back to the crazy stuff, the crazy impossible things, we would say that's impossible today, but the stuff that was committed or done on a daily basis by our ancestors. So we have some stories, like in 1835, a Native American who ran 100 miles in a day carrying 60 pounds, a 60-pound bar of lead on him. So not only just 100 miles, but he had 60 pounds on him. To me, that just sounds like crazy. I can't even imagine doing 100 miles as it is right now. I mean, I could. It would be really, really hard, but adding 60 pounds to that is just ridiculous, you know? Overall, I lost 70 pounds from my transformation from when I first started. So regaining that back or just putting that back on me and just trying to go for 100 miles just seems crazy. But it was done. You know, it was done by our people, by Native Americans up and down North America, right? 1860. This guy in his mid-50s, most people think that in their mid-50s they're done. You know, I don't run, I don't do anything, I'm in my mid-50s, right? But this guy in his mid-50s ran 400 miles. You know, so it's like, what's my excuse, right? What's anybody else's excuse, right? 1876, a Big Hawk chief ran 120 miles inside 24 hours. Even by today's standards and ultra runners, you know, that's still a remarkable feat, doing 120 miles in 24 hours. And this one, it's specifically 90 miles from Canandaigua to Niagara between sunrise and sunset. So that's about 12 to 14 hours, depending on what time of year he's done it. That's crazy. It took me 3 days to do 90 miles. And he did it like in 13, 14 hours. It's ridiculous. So it's like, this, what this tells me, and looking back on this, is like, we have been doing this for so long. Why is it so impossible for me to imagine that I can do it today? You know, it's because we've been disconnected from that part of ourselves. We've been separated from that part of ourselves. Part of it is because of boarding school, but part of it is because of what boarding school represents on a larger scale, is that what colonization, the larger effect colonization had on us and separating us from our true selves, whether that be a health and wellness lifestyle or, you know, running a crazy distance like we're capable of doing, right? And so when we take a look back, you're taking a look at the past, let's contrast that and juxtapose it against present day, right? In present day, if you look in Indian country, there's a lot of things that are just really at odds with what I believe our ancestors would kind of look at as, you know, something. If they, I would feel like if they saw a lot of things happening today, would they approve? And not just because it's different, but just because it's damaging to our communities. You know, you have a lot of Native youth. Suicide rates are really, really high for Native youth. Probably higher than any other youth group out there, right? You have, let's see, what else, alcoholism. 31.2% of Native Americans aged 2 to 5 are obese, right? So again, the obesity I was talking about. Obviously, political unrest within our own tribes. You know, treating each other horribly. I witnessed it firsthand. And if you're a California Native and you've attended any kind of tribal council meeting, you have some idea of what I'm talking about. Right, just the way we treat each other is just ridiculous. We don't even treat enemies as bad as we do sometimes in tribal meetings, right? So it's crazy. And this Palo Watch specifically, when we're talking about removal from homes. In 1903, the Kupa were removed from their homes, right? Their ancestral homes in the village of Kupa. They were moved to where they are currently, right? So they talk about this as being their Trail of Tears. But most people don't know is on June 1st, 2011, and February 1st, 2012, they also had another removal from their homes in the form of the Paula Enrollment Committee, right? They disenrolled a large amount of their members. So figuratively and literally just removing members of their own tribe from their home and being committed by people from within their own tribe, right? So a lot of this stuff, there's a lot of political issues and just a lot of social issues when we look at it that I feel like we've gone really far off of the red road. And what I mean by red road, it goes back to the black elk philosophy of having two roads. You have the black road, which is the road that, you know, you don't want to go on. And you have the red road, the righteous road, the road of truth, the road of doing good, right? So we've deviated from that. And so when we're looking at the run, there's a lot of reasons and there's a lot of aspects for the run, right? The one personal reason for me, it's obviously a personal run, so it's to ground myself in a deeper understanding of my past to guide me towards a strong future. And if we look at political, everything I said, we've departed from our cultural ways, and that caused a lot of political unrest, disenrollments, arguments over blood quantum, that becoming like a really big issue, you know, financial greed, embezzlement. You know, I wish it didn't happen as often as it did. And just seeing this as a youth, and kind of looking back to the past, I'm just like, how do we justify this to ourselves? How do we say that this is okay and that this is okay to be part of our culture? You know? So it's just like, I see a lot of things that I want to see change. But how do I go about changing that? Right? So I decided to do this in hopes that it would also change the way people see themselves. And bringing attention to these issues, you know, might cause them to take a second look at how they're doing, how they're treating themselves, and how they're treating people in their tribe. So the answer to all these problems could be simple, and that's to come back home, right? The idea of coming back home to a familiar place, right? Just to gain a deeper understanding of who you are and who you should be, you know, so that you can return to your true self, right? So coming back home literally and figuratively. So which way is home? It's a nice picture of me pointing to which way is home. This is on the, I think it's the beginning of the third day out there in Anza. So coming back home is not always going backwards. There's this idea that if you're moving back home with your parents, you're taking a step backwards. But that's not always necessarily true, right? Coming back home, it just means returning to a familiar place so in order that you can heal properly, right? Because we've been damaged. A lot of our communities have been damaged. So the appropriate thing to do is to return home so you can get that familiar food, so you can get that familiarity with people in your family, so you can get that connection back to yourself. And it's kind of related to the idea of decolonization, but it's not decolonization in the sense that I think decolonization has a very kind of, like, do everything opposite of what we've been taught or do kind of undo the effects that Western society has had on our communities. I think that takes a very antagonistic kind of approach to that thing, when I feel like coming back home just makes it a more positive-based approach to returning to our true selves. So sometimes returning home means something. It means a lot of things, right? It could mean returning to a healthy lifestyle, like I chose to do, right? It could mean returning to our physical capabilities, returning back to the idea that I can run 90 miles, right? Learning the language, relearning some of the traditions that might have died off. You know, there's a lot of ways to come back home, right? And so there's lots of things that we could learn from coming back home. So this is the route I took, just so you can see there's a map. It's in Corona where I started with Sherman Indian School in Riverside. And the dots you see are my roughly my resting points. So that's where I would end each day. The first day I ended it somewhere around Menifee. The second day ended it in Kuya, or right around the 371. And then the final day would be my final trip home. And so that's 90 miles covered in 3 days. Which, you know, it's crazy to a lot of people. It's crazy to me. You know, it was crazy to me when I thought about it. But the first day was 32.7, second day was 26.2, so that's a marathon distance. And then the third day was 31 miles. And so that's roughly, on average, about 30 miles a day, right? So that's like a marathon after a marathon after a marathon, more than a marathon. And so for me, just the whole idea of it still sounded crazy, even though I was like slowly starting to train for it and develop my running capabilities. Yeah, it's just a really big endeavor to take on. And so why I picked 3 days exactly and why I chose the distance, well, I mean, I could have ran 100 miles. 90 miles just kind of sounds a little bit more, you know, catchy. You run 100. When I know people are talking about 90-mile run, they're talking about my run, and they're not talking about some other run for the most part. Also, I knew it would be a challenge enough for me to, like, so it wouldn't be too easy for me. 3 days, 30 miles a day, it would be a big enough challenge for me to actually take something from it without it being too hard at the same time. All right. So this is an example of what the training looked like. Again, I trained for the whole year. I ran my first half marathon in March, my first full marathon in June of 2012, and then December and January is when the actual, like, heavy bulk of the training took place, because those were the final 2 months leading into my run. And so what it consisted of is long runs on the weekend, really long runs on the weekend, 30, 34, up to 40 miles. I remember that 40-mile run was crazy. And the point of doing that 40-mile run is not because I'm going to be doing, you know, 40 miles, it's to develop that one-time long endurance for that long run. So I knew I was able to handle the rest of it. But 40-mile run, what really signified, a switch in the training is that first 30-mile run that you see on December 1st. When I did that that run, and this is something that a lot of people learn about themselves when running. It was my first experience with this, so it was kind of a new thing, but that was the furthest distance I've ever ran before up to that point, and it was beyond a marathon. And the fact that I did it on a Saturday, it was like over 8 hours, I think, and there was nobody there to watch me. Only I was able to hold myself accountable for the action. So there was that moment when I crossed 26.2 where I'm like, you know, that's 26.2 miles. Most people would say that's good enough, right? I can let myself off the hook for the rest of the day. But I would always like to operate under, and I always tell the youth to operate, you know, to act as if your ancestors are watching. So if I'm cheating myself, you know, then somebody's going to be watching it and holding me accountable, even if I think there's nobody there, right? So I did 30 miles, and that signified a switch. That if I did 30 miles, like I said I was going to, that means I'm taking it seriously and that this is going to happen. So I knew as soon as I finished that 30 miles that 90 miles was going to happen, whether I liked it or not, right? Just because if I made it past that, it's going to happen. And so I did a lot of running around Mesa Grande and also in San Diego area. And January is not up here, but it looked kind of the same, obviously with tapering off in the mileage as it got closer to the actual run. And we're going into day one. So day one represented, and this is something I kind of learned along the way about what each day meant. Towards the end of the second day is when I kind of started piecing together the lessons that I was learning on the actual run. I'm a really introspective, analytical person, so just kind of really trying to extrapolate as much meaning out of everything that the run had to offer to me was really important. And so I think there's so much that this run has taught me that is really hard to include in this one slideshow, in this one presentation, but this is just kind of a snippet of the main points that I got on each day. So this is a shot of me taking off at Sherman Indian School with some runners that they had to join in with me. And so what day one represented was the hardest day of the run, I'd probably say the hardest day of my life, because it was raining all day, but not only that, I didn't hydrate properly for the first 10, 12 miles, and so what that resulted in is major cramping by mile 20, at which point I still had about 10, 11 miles left. And so that was more painful than the first marathon that I did. That was more painful than anything I've ever been through. But the importance of going through that is I was forced to deal with the mental aspect of it. The pain, obviously, is very present, but the mental aspect of it told me, like, oh my God, like, I'm not going to be able to do this. What was I thinking? There's people waiting on me back home, waiting for me to finish on Sunday. I'm not going to be able to make it by then. And so just kind of learning how important it is to kind of battle the mental aspect of it and learning the pain and the struggles of the past and how hard it must have been to do everything and to go through everything that our ancestors went through, right? And so that, remembering that as I was like kneeling like this to kind of, you know, stave off the cramps and barely walking forward as the last couple miles, you know, just remembering that was the purpose of me going through that pain, it really gave purpose to everything I was going through. And so that's what the first day had to offer. The second day, even though it was the shortest, it was just a marathon, it felt like the longest one because I was still sore. Obviously, this is my first run where I was starting the day off really, really sore. And I did, like, just the day, the rest I had in between helped so much, but it was still nothing to, you know, help the pain and the soreness the next day, right? So I had to take it slow. And it just felt really, really slow, right? So it was still raining. It was kind of clearing up a little bit. This is actually a picture of the third day. What happened on the second day is we had a cameraman, but he lost all of his footage. Somebody stole it from his car, so. Yeah. What I learned is how important it is to have patience, you know, in the things that I want to see change. There's lots of things that I want to see change and how I want to see them change. And I want to see them maybe in a year, a couple years, but a lot of the change that I want to see, I realize that it's important to have the patience because a lot of the change that I feel is necessary is going to happen over generations, right? Whether that be our eating, our lifestyles, or the way we treat each other, right? And so not being so demanding, the humbling idea of just checking myself in my, you know, desires, my judgments, and everything, right? Yeah. Yeah, the youth run, we were able to kind of put together a small youth run in the beginning of the day where we had the youth. And really, when you think about this run, that's why we had the youth run. This is why I had the run entirely is because it had everything to do with the youth, whether it be the youth from boarding schools, or the youth today that are dealing with suicide, or the youth today are dealing with the lifestyles that, you know, have been imposed upon them. So what I did is we organized a little 1 mile fun run, which we had a good amount of people show up to, and it was really just a fun day, fun way to get the day started. I mean, a lot of those kids were passing me up because I was barely, you know, getting the day started and limping off. But it was a really good day, and I ended up at Kauia, right at the intersection of the 79 and 371. And so day three, we have this idea of past, present, and future, right? So the first day was a representative struggle of past, the second day, the present, and then the third day, most importantly, and again, you know, about the youth, right? Hope for the future, right? So what this would mean is if I actually completed the third day, what that would mean for my tribe is that there's still hope for the future, you know, because there's things I see in my tribe that are kind of, you know, just really disappointing and depressing sometimes. But this day taught me to have hope, not only to be able to finish it, but what you see in this picture right here is me hitting up the Mesa Grande grade, which is the final stretch, pretty much. So it's mile 27 or so. This grade is really a sheer incline, so it was really hard. And I was dreading this and preparing for it. I'm like, I'm going to be dead by this point. I'm going to have to crawl up this mountain right here. But I had two kids who joined me from Mesa Grande. And, you know, their parents were kind of like iffy. It's like, we might show up, we might not. But they ended up showing up, which is really good because these two kids played almost a prophetic role in the entire run. Because at this point, what ended up happening is it became more of a dream. And I don't mean that in any kind of cliche way. It was literally like, you know, I talked about things happening to me and me not being a conscious agent. At that point, it was as if I was reading a book where the obviously the ending is predetermined and everything, but you know, I didn't know what was going to happen next, but the way I saw things, it might have been because I was delusional at the end of the run and I was tired. But the way I saw everything happening, it was just in this weird dream-like state. You know, everything was just happening with this surreal kind of film around it, right? So as we made our way up the hill, we had a caravan of people following us. Our chairperson right behind us, but who was in front? Thunder. Right? Thunder represented the youth, right? And he was even leading me. So he was in front and leading the entire group, which represented the tribe, right? So he represented hope for the future, and I actually told him that, you know, as he was running with me. Like, you know, you're representing hope for the future right now, right? He's like, no, I didn't, but that's pretty cool. Yeah, so it was just a really, I wish I could put into words exactly how that experience was. And I did write something up, like, you know, detailing that entire last part of it and how much of a dream it was. It felt like I was, you know, as people were coming by, like that, you know, they were riding up the hill. I was like, hey, Philip, glad we can catch you on the way up. We'll see you up on top. It was as if I was going to some kind of, like, proverbial afterlife, right? Like, I'm just like, whoa, you know. And again, this might be, you know, because I was tired at the end of the day, but it was just really weird to see all these people coming together from different areas who had no other connection other than coming together for me for this run. And so really when we think about what this run and what it meant, is that's exactly what I wanted to happen, people to come together, people from my tribe coming together and being a tribe again. And that's what I saw happen at the end of the day. When we were all gathered there, not everybody liked each other, right? Obviously, people have issues with each other and drama, but we were able to come together, you know, and just at least for just even a split second, just put aside the differences, you know, and just celebrate this one achievement for the entire community. The amount of pride that was felt by everybody in Mesa Grande that day, you can't put into words. I imagine that's how, you know, that's how we originally were. Very prideful people, but we've been separated from that. And to see that happen, it was exactly like seeing a dream come true, right? So we were proud once again. And that doesn't happen too much if you know Mesa Grande. It doesn't really happen at all. And to have that sense of pride, like, hey, look, this guy is from our tribe. You know, he did this amazing achievement. You know, he's young and he's within our tribe. You know, the my chairperson apparently was bragging about it for months after it happened, right? But yes, the final day represented hope for the future. And so I was able to finally come back home with the message. And the message was that there is hope to the hope for the future. And that was represented in these youth right here who ran with me. And so this is a picture of me at the finish. I really like this picture because it really, I feel like it captures a lot of the happiness and just the pure emotion that I was feeling at the end of it. There's just so much going on in the picture. I mean, also my sister giving somebody a shirt is also cool to have in there. But, you know, you have that, there's a lot of things going on here. And, you know, I say it right here in my quote, but it's just, you have the medallion you have right here, and it's looking at, I wish I had it here just to talk about it, but just even in kind of retrospect and just kind of looking at it, it just taught me so much just by looking. If you see on our flyer, yeah, right here, you might not be able to see it, but there's a picture of like a runner, like a silhouette of a runner. And he's followed by a couple of runners behind him, right? And so in that one that was made by Rob Christman from Via Heights, he made that and was given to me by Whitney after the run. You actually have two runners. One of them is, both of them are smaller than the big one, but one is slightly smaller than the other one. So what that kind of represented was those two kids who actually came up with me. And so it was just tripping me out afterwards that I realized that, because it was almost like it was prophesied, it was meant to happen. And so I learned a lot about just like challenging my ideas of kind of time and my kind of agency and things. I like to believe that, you know, I like to believe that I'm a conscious agent, you know, with free will, that I was, you know, that I did this 90-mile run. But what that really tells me is that I was really just, you know, I was meant to do this and I was just acting it out. And so whatever else I'm going to be doing in my life, you know, I'm going to have choices in my life, things I'm going to do that I think I have free will in, but you know, there's some things that I can't really take all the credit for because it was given to me by birth, by my ancestors, by just, you know, just by being who I am and being part of my tribe, right? And so if we look at this picture, I have a quote. This is something I put on my Facebook, but you know, this is something that they made a page for. Roy Cook decided to put this on the local sports heroes page. I completed my 3-day. Oh God, it's not good ideas. Wow. Okay, let's not prophesize that. Okay. but I completed my 3-day 90-mile spirit run from Sherman Indian School back home in Mesa Grande, in honor of my great uncle Alfonso Soto. I changed my life in hopes that I can inspire others to do the same. Running has taught me a lot of things, and this one-year journey of mine became something bigger than I could have ever imagined. They say a picture is worth 1,000 words. Let's just say there aren't enough words in the English language to describe this picture. Yay, come. My heart is good. And so there's just, like I said, I wish there was some way I could really just capture the essence of everything that I learned. But the reason why this is important, the reason why it ties back to the idea of continuum, is this idea of, we have this idea that the past is the past, and the present is the present, and the future is the future. But they're all kind of enveloped and kind of connected to each other. And we can't really separate them. I can't separate my past from my present. You know, obviously, you know, the fact that I was able to do that, you know, just tells me that coming from a non-running background, coming from this really unhealthy lifestyle, the fact that I was able to get up and train for this and do this tells me that, you know, it's part of who I am. It's part of my past and it's part of who I am. And so the reason why this is important is because not too many people actually witnessed this happen. You know, it was kind of like a small, low-key event. But what this signifies is a change that really can take place within our youth. You know, whether that be through somebody like me or somebody who might have seen me do something and get inspired by what I do. Like those kids who ran with me. You know, they were in so much pain that day. I remember Thunder, he's like, oh, my foot's hurting, can we slow down? I'm like, dude, there's like cars behind us. Like, you gotta get going. Like, about to end this thing. He's like, oh, okay. You know, and I told him, I was like, hey, look, you know, this pain might, you know, be really painful right now, but his memory is gonna last you forever. And I'm pretty sure he's gonna always remember that time where he ran out of the Mesa Grande grade with me and to end that spirit run. And so that's why something like this is so important, because what I like to do and what this run has taught me is obviously giving me guidance to go in the next step of my life. But it enabled me to kind of talk to you in a way that I wasn't able to do so before I did this run. Because it's one thing talking about things, it's another thing doing them. You know, so I'm able to tell them to have crazy dreams because they can come true. Right, this run, having it happen was just like a dream, right? And it came true. Right? And so I'm able to tell them to all the things that I've learned on this run. And I'm able to tell them to that if I can do it, and you know, a lot of these kids come from the same community as I did. So if I can do it, you can do it, obviously. You know, I mean, and I had everything going against me, but it's within ourselves and it's within our communities. We just got to come back home. And so, I think I'm going to wrap this up, but I wanted to thank you for your attention. I know it was lunch, and you guys are kind of, you could probably be kind of dozing off right now. I may not even be able to tell, but I appreciate those of you who are paying attention. And I'm going to wrap it up with this video. This is the end of day two, or the beginning of day three. At the intersection of 79 and 371, where I was beginning day number three. And this is it's Whitney's nephew and Whitney's grandma. And they're seeing me off. It was a good day. They were the only ones to see me off that day, but it was really cool. Yeah. Okay, so we're going to watch this video, which is just a little clip of my run put together with music from Johnny Cash. And if you listen to the lyrics, they go along with exactly what the run is about, and you take into consideration the political aspects of it and everything entirely.
Back, tell them the gods gone, cut you down, tell them the
Okay. Thank you very much, like I said. And if we have time for questions, if anybody has questions, now would be the time to ask them. If not, I'll be around, like, I'll still be around here if we don't have time. But I think we have time for a couple questions.
Were you holding an eagle feather at the end?
Yes, yes.
Was that presented to you after?
Yes, that was presented to me, one by my chairperson, another by somebody who I know through one of the programs that I work with.
Very special.
Yeah. Yeah, right? Like, you know what? After I did this run, I swear, I was like, the part of the reason why I was able to get through this is because I told myself through the run, I'm never going to have to do this again. After this, I'm never going to have to run again. Right? But I still run, unfortunately, I guess. I think I lied to myself when I told myself that. But, you know, I allowed myself a month break, and so I still run. I still compete in races and stuff. And I actually, because of this, I know exactly what I want to do with my life and my calling in a way that I probably wouldn't have figured out if I didn't do this. And again, it ties back to kind of my purpose and everything. But and it has a lot to do with endurance and endurance events. And so the next stage in my life, what that means is I'm going to, and I can say this with 100% conviction because I was able to do this, I'm going to be Ironman world champion. Hopefully before the next 10 years. I want to do it sooner than that, but I'm giving myself until 2024 to be able to do that. And I know without a shadow of a doubt that I'm able to do that because, not only because I was able to do this run, but because we were able to do it for a long time. And so doing this run allowed me to have that conviction. And so that's what I'm doing right now, and that's what I'm going to be doing for the future.
Mm-hmm. You're working with the students or the kids right now too?
Yeah. Yeah, we work with different tribes and different communities, and I just talked to the youth about leadership qualities and from a cultural aspect, whether that be walking the red road or the importance of ancestral perspective and having that understanding of yourself. And so that's part of our youth leadership program, so we can kind of give them that guidance.
I'm curious if you're interested in pursuing tribal sort of leadership.
Yeah, you know what? There's a time and a place for it, I think. Now's not the time or the place, I think. I mean, I could very well get involved because it's such a small tribe. And, you know, people in my tribe after this, they want me to get involved in terms of, like, you know, some people were even joking around with my dad, like, he should be chairperson, I nominate him. You know? But it's like, you know, I think that goes along with the humility and patience and kind of recognizing my time and place and when would be appropriate for me to get involved on that level. But yeah. People are talking about doing this again next year. They were talking about that when it was over. They're like, what about next year? And, you know, this is supposed to be a one-time thing, so I would say don't expect this to happen again. It's kind of like a once-in-a-lifetime thing. But with that, again, it doesn't mean that it's never going to happen again, you know. It might be not for me, it could be for another youth who wants that kind of guidance. So, and it might be just a one day go, you know, 90 miles straight. But yeah, thank you for your time. If you have any more questions, I'll be around.